Well, good morning. Welcome to Park Church. It's good that you're here. My name is Matt. I am one of the pastors here on staff. You see from that graphic up on the screen, we've been in a series of sermons that has been looking at grieving and growing. It's been looking at loss and pain and suffering, and specifically how God wants us to face these very, very difficult things. And I have to say, I could say this because I haven't spoken yet in this series, although I guess I spoke this morning, so it doesn't count anymore, but it's been fantastic. The guys like Brian, who spoke a few weeks ago, and Doug for the last few weeks, and Tom last week, they've done a really masterful job talking about a theme, a topic that's really difficult, and that's really personal, and that a lot of churches don't dive into because it's just too hard. I've spoken to a lot of people, and I've heard about the groups and how they've been going, and I've heard about the class that's been run on this topic. And I know for a lot of you, this has been really kind of an eye-opening thing to go through. You've lost big things in the past, big people in your past, or you know, you've lost little things, and you've never really taken the time to consider grief and the way God wants us to go through these things in any sort of depth. And this has been the first time, and it's been really revelatory for some people. I had one person tell me that this has been a life-changing thing for her just to sit and experience this kind of new way of looking at things. It is really hard, though. It's not easy to go through. It's you know, it kind of matches the feel of the morning, kind of gray, kind of bleak. I know for some of you, this is just not something that you want or need. I don't know why. Maybe because it's just too the nerve is too raw. It hits too acutely. But for all of you who are here, who are going through this together, talking about it with one another, coming on Sundays and just listening and being a part of it, talking about it in groups, praying through these things, reading the book that we've been going through, I want to say to you that I am really proud of you for going through this. I also work as a chaplain at a local hospital, and I run a bereavement group for adults who have lost their spouses or their loved ones, and I can tell you, the people who come to that group, who have not yet faced their grief at all, or who thought I could do this without really facing it, or just I could put it off and put it off and put it off, or maybe I can just shove it all the way down deep inside of me. Those people, the grief, it always comes back. And it hurts worse then than it does at the time. And so for us to kind of face these things together as a community, as hard as it might be, I'm really proud of you for it. And I think God is really proud of us for doing this. Because God wants us to grieve. We heard that last week. The Psalms are full of grief. But God also wants us to grow. And if we don't talk about it together, if we don't work through it together, if we don't have a month of sermons on this sort of thing, we'll never grow. And so I'm really happy that we're doing this together. All of that being said, this is the last sermon in the series on grieving and growing. It'll continue in the groups and the class for another week or two, but next week we're kicking off a new series on the Beatitudes that I'm really excited about. So the question that I want to start with this morning, it's a question that I imagine is behind all of our suffering. If you suffer, you've asked this question, I'm sure. The question is why? Why suffering? Why did God allow me to go through the thing that I just went through, right? Why did your mom get sick and die when she shouldn't have? Why did your husband do that thing that ruined your marriage and now your family's broken apart because of it? Why would God allow this? Why? What's the meaning behind these things? We ask this question because if we think we can find out the answer to why, if we think we can find the meaning behind it, then maybe it will make the grief more bearable. Maybe it will make what seems senseless a little more sensible. Maybe we can make the meaninglessness seem more meaningful, right? Meaninglessness is not something that we do well with as humans. It's exhausting. It's depressing. It wears us out. It drags us down. And it leads us into hopelessness. And what it does is it ruins our faith. It destroys it. Now, I do want to get one thing on the table, though, before we go forward about this why question. Some suffering makes sense, right? If you get into a car accident because you're drinking and driving and you are permanently, you know, paralyzed, or that suffering kind of makes sense. If you smoke cigarettes all your life and you come down with lung cancer, well, that suffering makes sense, right? If you cheat on your wife and your family is ruined and your life is ruined because of that, that suffering kind of makes sense. It's hard to kind of not know the answer to that one. The problem is, though, what about the family that you crashed into who lost a wife and a daughter in an incident? Where's their explanation, you know? The guy in the chemo chair next to you who has the same exact cancer that you do but has never smoked a cigarette in his life, you know? Where's his meaning? What about the kids who are left behind in a marriage that's crumbled and have forever had their image of what a father and what a man and what love looks like? That's been shattered for them. Where's the meaning for them? How do they answer that question? How do they answer the why? Now, I have some good news and some bad news about this question. The good news is the Bible gives us a lot of kinds of answers to these questions. If you look at the Bible, you'll find them. The bad news is it doesn't really give us the kind of answers we want, at least not yet, at least not at first. If you look at the Bible and ask these big kind of questions, there's a few big answers. The first one kind of comes out of one of the very first stories in the Bible, the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve, right? This is a picture of kind of perfect humanity, perfect world. This is a picture before there was anything wrong. And here's the story. God tells Adam and Eve, don't do this thing. What do Adam and Eve do? Because they're humans, they do this thing. And because of the thing they did, they suffer, right? They're kicked out of the garden and they suffer. And what the Bible is doing here, what it's telling is, this is the story of all of us. We have all, in one way or another, in great ways and small, we have all rebelled against God. And because of that, something called sin, and I'll call it capital S sin, sin is a factor in our world. It has infiltrated us. It's infected us. It's in everything. It's in everything. And because of that, things like sicknesses and things like loneliness and things like wars and violence and diseases, these things exist in some way or another because of sin. And that's an answer. That's an answer for why. The world just isn't the way God meant it to be. And so nothing is perfect, hence suffering. So that's one kind of story. That's one answer. But that doesn't really answer a lot of the questions, right? If you look, move ahead in the Bible, there's a book called Job, right? This is about a guy named Job. His story goes like this. He was a kind of faithful, really righteous man. Satan, God's kind of enemy, Satan wants to mess with Job. And so Satan, you know, ends up making Job suffer. He loses his family. He loses his property. He loses his health. His entire life falls apart. And so he asks the question of God, why? Why? What's behind this guy? What's the meaning behind all of this? Job has some helpful friends who come along, and they say, you know, Job, this has got to be your fault. You have to have done something to deserve this. I don't know what, maybe you did something, maybe you had the wrong attitude about God. This is all on you, Job, for doing this. And Job's answer to them is like, well, kind of, guys, but I hear what you're saying, but I actually don't think that's the case with me. I think I've actually been pretty good here. And so Job continues to ask God, why? What is behind this? Why? What's the meaning? At the end of this long book, God finally gives Job the answer. He speaks to him out of this whirlwind. It's kind of a big scene. It's hard to imagine. God speaks about all kinds of things he's done, and there's lots of big language and powerful imagery and whatnot. But at the heart of what God says to Job is, Job, I could give you the answer you're looking for, but if I gave it to you, your head would explode. Your mind is just not big enough to handle the answer. The answer is too big for you to comprehend. It's beyond you. I can't fully give you the why, the meaning behind suffering, because your head would explode. And so what I want you to do, Job, is worry less about what's behind suffering, the meaning behind it, and instead I want you just to trust me. I want you to know, Job, that I created you. I created the world, the heaven and the earth and everything in it. I was here before you were born, and I'll be here long after you're dead. So trust me, Job. God is much less interested in this moment of what's behind suffering, the meaning behind it, and much more interested in what's ahead, what's to come, right? Fast forward again to Jesus. There's a story in the Gospel of John that is about a time where Jesus' followers see a man who was born blind. This was a guy who's been blind all of his life. And his followers ask him, hey, Jesus, why is this guy suffering like this? Why is he blind? Is it because he sinned or his parents sinned or what's the story? His followers are looking for an answer that will make sense out of his suffering. Jesus, in typical Jesus fashion, gives them an answer that's not at all the answer they're looking for. He says to them, neither. They didn't sin. He didn't sin. This man is suffering like this, interestingly enough, so that the works of God might be revealed, might be shown in him and through him. And what ends up happening is Jesus heals the man. And people see God's powerful transformative work in this man's blindness, in his suffering. Jesus is less interested in what's behind suffering, the meaning behind it, and he's more interested in what God's transforming power can do out of it, what God can do with it. And this is where we land this morning. This is where the Bible lands, and this is, I think, where Jesus lands. It's much less interested in answering the why, because believe me, I could give you a reading list of 200 books that debate the why. All of them are right and wrong at the same time. The Bible's pretty clear, though. It's less interested in the why, the meaning, and more interested in the what now. What is God going to do with this now that I've suffered? And if this sounds like I'm saying to you or the Bible saying to you, just get over it and move on, that's not what I'm saying. That's not what the Bible is saying at all. I actually really appreciate this about the Christian faith, about Christianity, is it doesn't explain away suffering. It doesn't make excuses for it. It doesn't let God off the hook. It doesn't let us off the hook. It doesn't cheapen it or lessen it or relativize it or tell it that it's not really as bad as you think it is. It says, yes, it is that bad. Yes, it is. And we wish it wasn't, but it is. And God can bring something good out of it. And that's what we're going to get into here in a moment. So the thing I want to spend our time with this morning is actually a passage from 2 Corinthians, which I'll get to because it's working. Bobby, thank you. Not the answer of the meaning behind suffering, but rather out of this suffering. How do I make meaning? Out of my loss, my pain, my grief, how do I find something good? You may never know why you've suffered. You may never know this side of eternity, the meaning behind it. You may never understand it, and you should and will still shake your fist at God and say, why, God, why? But I want to open up to you this morning what Paul says, what God has to say about how God can bring meaning out of your suffering. So we'll take a look at Paul's second letter to the Corinthians, the Corinthian church. This was a church of people in Corinth, which was in modern-day Greece. Paul was a guy who wrote a lot of the New Testament. He would start or be part of churches, and he would send them letters to help them out, to help them figure out stuff. That's how we've gotten a lot of our New Testament. The Corinthian church was an important church for Paul. He loved it, and this is good news for us. It was a church with a lot of problems. It was a church that, you know, the first letter to the Corinthians is kind of all about this. It was a church full of conflict. It was a church that did stuff that would make anyone blush. It had hit the fan at this place. Sins happened that needed to be forgiven. Reconciliation needed to happen at this place. And that's what 1 Corinthians is really all about. The fact that 2 Corinthians exists means that churches can get through these things and grow through them. Okay? When churches go through conflicts, though, coupled with the persecution around them, we don't suffer that, thankfully, but coupled with the persecution around them, what happens is you have a group of people who are hurting. You have a group of people who have lost something and who are in need of comfort. And so Paul writes this letter, 2 Corinthians, into that context of a group of Christians who needed comfort. And so that's why he starts the letter off like he does. And here it is. He writes, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort." Now, that's just like the introduction to what he has to say, but it says something that I want to make sure everyone here gets. This is our basis for everything, okay? I don't know what you believe about God. Kind of, if you're new here, I don't know what you've heard about him. I don't know. But this is who we believe God is. God is the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. Notice, he's not the father of petty judgment. He's not the father of, I told you so. He's not the father of, you did this, and now you should suffer because of it. He's not the father of, those aren't my people to worry about. He's the father of mercy, which means that when he sees someone who is in need of mercy, whether they deserve it or not, whether they've earned it or not, he's going to be merciful to them. The father of mercies looks at this world and sees a problem like this refugee crisis and says, I don't really care where those people come from. I don't really care who they worship. They're people who are in need, so I'm going to give them mercy, which is why I'm really thankful and excited that our church together is going to work on how to extend God's mercy to those people, to the outsider. That's something we should always be about. God is also the God of all comfort. And this is where I'm going to hone in on this word comfort this morning. Comfort is sort of a big word in 2 Corinthians. It's littered throughout it. And it's a common word. We use comfort all the time. But it's a word that I think, if we're not careful with, we'll miss what Paul intends up here. When we think of comfort, what do we think of? What? Food. Yes, food. You think of comfort food. Right, comfort food. I do think of food. I think of it all the time. I think of my comfy slippers that smell really bad because I don't wear socks with them and, you know, whatever. I think of my comfy sweatpants that I just love to wear. If I could, I would be in my black sweatpants right now and you would all be dealing with it. I think of my high thread count sheets on my bed and the fluffy pillow top that's underneath them and how wonderful that makes me feel. I think of my comforter. We have something we sleep under every night that's literally called a comforter, right? They sell these things now that are heavy comforters because studies have shown that if you have a heavy comforter on you when you sleep, it actually reduces stress and things like that because there's something very warm and comforting about that weight on you. When Paul talks about comfort, there's a resonance of that in what he's talking about, but that's not the heart of what he means by that. This word comfort, it's an English translation of Latin, and when you put it together, it's like co meaning with, right? Co-mingle, that sort of thing, coexist, co, and then fort is where we get our word fortitude from. It means strength. So come fort means with strength. So to comfort someone means to bring them strength. And specifically, it means to bring them strength that you have, that they don't have, that now they're strengthened by. It's to gain strength by the strength of another. That's broadly what it means to comfort someone. So notice then, to be comforted doesn't mean to make us comfortable in the way that we think of being comfortable, right? It could still be uncomfortable, but we're strengthened. To be comforted is to be given strength in the midst of your pain. Strength to persevere in the middle of that thing that makes you feel uncomfortable. And this is important to note because Paul is not saying God is the God of comfy slippers and books in front of a fire. Although those things are wonderful and I hope God is the God of those things too because I love those things. But God is so much more. And this is important to know. Again, I don't know what you believe about God or anything like that, but this is important to know that this is who the Bible tells us God is, the God who comforts. The God who comes to give strength when strength is needed in the midst of affliction doesn't make your pain go away necessarily, but he's going to give you strength in it. And so Paul continues, he's the God who comforts us in all our afflictions. And I love this. This is easy to miss, but he comforts us in all our afflictions, every single one of them. Not the ones that you deserve to be comforted with, not the ones that aren't really your fault, but he comforts you in all our afflictions. This is God. He is our go-to comforter who is more than willing to comfort us in any and all of our afflictions. And I want you to think for a moment. Is that your experience of God? If it is, then you're on the right track and there's work that I'm going to give you to do later in the sermon. If that's not your experience with God, then I think you're on the wrong track and I hope that you can get on the right track. And then there's work I can give you to do at the end of the sermon. We'll get back to it. So as Paul continues, though, he moves on to the part that is really of the most interest to us. Why does God comfort us like this? Why so lavishly? Why so willingly? Look at what he says. So that we may be able to comfort those who are in any affliction with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. Did you catch what Paul said there? It's kind of a jumbled up phrase. I'm sure in Greek it's much more elegant. But God means to comfort us so that the comfort we received is not just held onto by us, but it's then passed on to someone who needs it, right? For you note takers, or if you're not a note taker, I hope you can all memorize what I'm about to say, because this is Paul's point. This is my point for this morning. You ready? God does not comfort us to make us comfortable. God comforts us to make us comforters. God does not comfort us to make us comfortable. It's not our personal possession. It's not ours. In this culture, we think about comfort like that, right? It's, you know, it's my experience of the book in front of the fire. It's my high thread count sheets. It's why we need first class, because we need that luxury. We need that comfort. We've earned it. We've deserved it. In this culture, we worship at the altar of comfort, because we've been tricked into thinking that that the highest form human beings can attain is that of comfort. And once we've attained that comfort, there's nothing else for us. I think this is one of the reasons why popular images of heaven are a bunch of people lazy on clouds, right? This is the highest we attain to. We sit around on clouds and do nothing all day. Look, in God's mind, in God's world, in God's economy of comfort, that's not at all what humanity is for. Look at the life of Jesus. It did not get easier. His was one of discomfort. Comfort, though, when God does give it to us, it does make us feel better. It does comfort us. It does warm us in the way that we normally think about it. And if you've had that experience, you know that there's almost nothing better than when God gives you the relief that you need, when God gives you the peace that you need, when God, even for a moment, helps you to feel at home in his arms in the midst of your trouble. The problem, or the opportunity, is it's not for us to enjoy alone. When God comforts you, it's given to you as a responsibility. It's given to you as a calling to then use that comfort later to comfort someone else, to become a mediator of God's comfort like that. God comforts us to make us comforters. And here is where our suffering, our pain, the loss, here is where it can have meaning. Here is where God can bring meaning out of it. It's not that you suddenly understand why. It's not that you suddenly have sense made out of senseless suffering. This doesn't cliche it. It doesn't platitude it, hopefully. But rather, you've suffered. You may not understand it, but you have found comfort. And now is when you can make meaning out of it. Now is when something good can come out of it. And God means for you to be active in that. God means for you to be the mediator of it, which will not only redeem your pain, but it will also redeem you in the process. And so for the Christian, for the person who understands this, affliction and suffering and grief and loss and pain, distress, these things are neither meaningless nor purposeless, but they find meaning and purpose as God makes meaning and purpose out of them, as God co-opts them, as he takes them over and redeems them for good. He means to turn our pain into comfort and transforming it into hope and healing, salvation for someone else. And this makes sense because this is the basic direction of all of God's redemption, right? Jesus suffered so that we don't have to. Jesus was condemned on the cross so that we might be set free and saved. Jesus died so that we could live. By his wounds, we are healed. If we are to call ourselves followers of this Jesus, then it stands to reason that the things that cause us pain are also meant to be comfort for someone else. That's how we follow Jesus in this. He doesn't comfort us to make us comfortable. He comforts us to make us comforters. And so what might be on your mind then is, okay, this is good. How do I actually receive God's comfort in the first place? Really on the ground, what does this look like? And I'll give you a few kind of answers to how that happens. First, it's through other people who have been comforted by God, other Christians who care for us. If our calling is to comfort others with the comfort we've been given, then it stands to reason someone else who's been comforted by God also can comfort us. And that's how we receive comfort from other people. And I bet for those of you who have experienced that, there's not much better than a Christian brother or sister being with you who has been through it before and who knows what you're going through, and who can give you wisdom and insight that you can trust that you haven't had, and who can pray you through these things. There's not much better than that. If you don't have Christian relationships where that can happen, please stick around here and form some, or find some other church where you can form those things. It's one of the functions of our community groups every week, is to put people in situations where they can find comfort in one another. All right, a second way God comforts us, and this is kind of paradoxical, it kind of must be lived to be understood. God comforts us when we take time to care for others. Have you ever had the experience of serving someone in need and walking away saying, you know what, I actually was helped in that? It's not always God's comfort, that thing. That might just be a human psychological thing. But I think sometimes God honors the turn from selfishness to selflessness in service and says, I'm going to give this person strength to do this, to get through it. I'm going to encourage them with this. And it happens. When you serve other people, it just happens that you get strengthened through it. A third way that God comforts us is when we see it in other people. When we witness it in other people's lives, when we see other people transformed, when we hear stories of people coming to faith in baptisms, right? We're built up. We're encouraged. Our hearts are warmed and strengthened by that. It's one of the best things about the work that I get to do is I get to listen to people and hear their stories of what God is doing and God is transforming. And man, it gives me hope. It gives me peace. It gives me strength for the future. It's one of the reasons why together, we need to be more intentional about talking about what God is doing in our lives together, all right? The fourth way that God comforts us, and this might be the most important, that's why I put it last, it's as we come closer to Jesus. It's as we come to know Jesus deeper. It's as we come to know what he's done for us. Look at how Paul finishes this section. He says, for just as the sufferings of Christ are abundant for us, so also our comfort is abundant through Christ. As you come to know who Jesus is, as you come to know better what he's done for you, if you come to know the abundance of his sufferings, it cannot but strengthen you. Isn't it strengthening to know that we have a God who loves us so much as to never let us go? That we have a God who came and gave his own life on the cross and into death so that we can live. Isn't it comforting to know that whatever you have done, whatever you have been, nothing can change the fact that Christ died for you because he loves you? Does it give you strength and hope and peace and confidence to know that even in the darkest valley, even as you walk in the valley of the shadow of death, even if you've turned and walked away, even if you've made your bed in the gates of hell, it says, Jesus chases after you still. He waits for you with open arms. His loving mercy is for you, and nothing will be able to separate you from the love of God in Jesus Christ, because he is the Savior of your soul. As you draw closer to these truths, as you draw closer to the truth, Jesus comforts you in these things. It's part of the reason why we worship like we do on Sundays, why we sing songs like we do. It's part of the reason why we have communion every week, to be reminded that his body was broken and his blood was shed for us, and that ought to give us strength and comfort and send us forward. It's why we pray together, and this happens. God strengthens us as we lift up our eyes to God and say, God, help us, when we cry out to him, when we're candid with him. It happens when we open scripture together, or on our own, and just hear God's word speaking to us. It gives us the strength and the comfort that we need to move forward. It's abundant, this comfort. That's how we're comforted by God. And that's a snapshot of comfort. It's how God wants us to have our pain transformed into comfort for us, but also for someone else. So now the question I'll turn to is from sort of this stuff to you. How's it going for you? How is your suffering? How is your pain, your loss? Tom talked about distress last week. How's your distress? Have you received, are you receiving God's comfort for it? If you have, I bet you know it, and you should be grateful. If you haven't, I'm going to borrow the words from a message a few weeks ago. maybe you're doing it wrong. Maybe you're looking for the wrong kind of comfort. You're looking to be made comfortable in the midst of your suffering. But really what God wants is to give you strength in the midst of something that's probably going to continue to feel uncomfortable. You're looking for the wrong kind of comfort. Maybe you're looking for comfort in the wrong place. You're looking at it through self-medication, through drugs, through abusing alcohol, through abusing food, through diving into a relationship that you know makes you kind of feel good, but it's really not going to be good for you. Or just trying to avoid it. I mean, we all do this. I do this. When I'm going through something that I don't want to go through, my comfort is distraction. And I will get on TV or I'll get on the internet and Facebook and I'll read any political article that I can come across just because it distracts me. It doesn't make me feel any better. It doesn't bring me comfort, but it makes me avoid it for a little while. We look for comfort in the wrong places. Maybe you're looking for comfort in yourself, within your inner resources. And that's good as far as it goes, but the problem is it doesn't go very far. By definition, we don't have the strength that we need to get through the things that we need more strength to get through, if that makes sense. So we look for comfort in the wrong places. If you haven't experienced God's comfort, here's what I'll say to you. Continue to seek Him out. Continue to come on Sundays here or somewhere else and hear what God does have to say. Try to meet God at a place like this. Get into a community group or a smaller group of other Christians where you can take a chance on relationships with other Christians who can help bring you God's comfort. Get serious about your relationship with God, about opening yourself up to prayer, to talking to Him, about opening up the Scriptures more regularly. Turn or return to Christ. If we can help you with that, let us know. That's what those white Connect cards are for. So to those of you who have experienced God's strengthening comfort, though, for yourself, God does not comfort us to make us comfortable. He comforts us to make us comforters. So how can you put the comfort you've received into action for someone else? That's it for today. That's the challenge. It's a simple one, but if we miss this, I think we miss too much. So think about it. You who have lost someone close to you, but have found God's great consolation through people walking alongside of you, listening to your grief, bearing witness to your pain, not throwing platitudes at you, not telling you to get over it, but who is really with you in your loss. What this passage calls you to is simply to be that for someone else. For you who have experienced the breakdown of a marriage, where you've been betrayed, where it's all fallen apart, but you've found God's comfort through a friend or a group of friends who have carried you through it, who have encouraged you, given you wisdom, has shepherded you through it into greater growth, and has prayed you forward every step of the way. You now are called to be a mediator of that comfort to someone who needs it. You who know what it's like to be picked last on the team or has to sit alone at lunch. For you who's been ruined by a relationship and knows what that's like, or who's faced genuine disappointment in your family or your friends or a group of church who's turned your back on you, but you found comfort in it, you now have an opportunity, have a calling to go and pass that on to someone else. Seek out opportunities to comfort others with the same comfort with which you've been comforted by God. And I guarantee you, once you start to look, you will find those people, and they will find you. And if that doesn't work, just ask God, and He will show you. Because God, I don't believe God wants any of our suffering to be meaningless. He doesn't want you to grieve without hope. He doesn't want you to have pain for the sake of pain. What He wants is for His comfort in you to be used as comfort for someone else also. That's how we make sense out of senseless suffering, bring something good out of something so bad. That's His plan. That's His plan for you. That's His plan for us. And listen, what would the witness of the Church of Jesus Christ be if we all took this charge seriously? Not just Park Church, but the church worldwide. What would it be? One thing, I think the church would be better liked. And I don't mean liked as in like the world approves of what we do, but the church wouldn't be known by the things we hate, the people we hate, the things we're against. But the Church of Jesus Christ would be known by a bunch of people who bust their butt to comfort and to bring hope and to bring peace to other people. That's going to be a really good witness in the world. Amen. I'll tell you what else. Jesus would be better liked. Because people would see the way Jesus people do things, and they would say, if that's the way Jesus people act, then maybe this Jesus guy isn't that bad also. The sick, the lonely, the outcast, the refugee would not be left to their own devices, to their own strength, because Christians would be tripping over themselves, running to try to help, to try to bring comfort, to try to bring peace, to try to bring hope where there is no hope. We don't have control over the church out there, but we do have control over the church in here, kind of, because you're it. So let's be like this for this area. Let's be a church of people who are known in Monmouth County, in this area, for being great comforters, for being strengtheners of people who need strength, for being hope givers for people who need hope, for being people who bring about salvation for people who need saving. We can all do this. We can. Not because of our great hearts, not because we're particularly good at it, or we have our hearts in the right place, or because of our chaplain degrees or therapy certificates or whatever. We can do this. Because his comfort is abundant. Abundant means overflowing. It means more than we can hold. If we open ourselves up, if we open our pain, if we open our grief, if we open our conflict, if we open up what we've been through to the healing power of God and say to God, yes, transform us, take us through this, renew us, the comfort that we will receive as a community and as individuals will absolutely overflow. It will be abundant into this world around us. So let's be those people. Let's take God's healing for life's losses into our workplaces, into our schools, into our families, into our neighborhoods, and be these people in Monmouth County. Let's do it in here with one another, and let's do it out there. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for this excellent passage that you've given us from your servant Paul. Thank you for your abundant comfort for us. Thank you for your abundant sufferings on our behalf. Lord, we ask that you would help us as individuals, as a church, to draw closer to you, to know the sufferings you underwent for our behalf. Lord, speak to us, reshape our hearts and our mind and our souls by the power of what you've suffered for us through the cross, through your death, and into your resurrection. Lord, give us comfort in abundance for the things that we're suffering with, for our losses, our grief, our pain. Lord, help us to face these things. Help us to be honest about them. Help us to be courageous in the way that we face things we never wanted to face before. But Lord, give us strength for them. And use us moving forward as people who can help others who are in need, who have their own affliction to go through. Lord, we put this church, this body of people here into your hands, knowing that you love it, that you have a plan for it, and that you are leading it forward by the power of your Spirit. We pray, Lord, that we would become comforters in the world as we bear witness to you, who is the Savior of our souls. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.